In this time, my hope is that we'll figure out, as Jews, how to speak truth to power. To figure out what that means, we've gained a lot of access in this country. There was a time in Europe where in a period of 200 years, Jews were expelled from every major country in Europe. Everyone, Europeans, did that to us. And yet in this day and age, as we talk about anti-Semitism, and we talk about the people that we have to find a way to get connected with, we're not talking about the ways in which Europeans, white folks, did not take up arms in our name. White folks subjected Jews to serious subjugation. So why is it, as we go to think about coalition, we so worried about black folk? The people who have hurt Jewish people the most across history look nothing like me. They look more like most people in here. Okay? That is truth. So when we go to look at the nature of our struggle, we have to go to the place of understanding. We understand what it means to viscerally to be in while being out. To be in while feeling so afraid of being marginalized that we don't imagine that it's ever going to be real. It's only temporary, right? This is the way we've understood ourselves. But we have to be so far in that we understand that the condition of our being in is that we speak truth to power, like Esther. But for this moment, who knows why you have been brought here, is what Mordecai said to Esther, right? You're scared? You don't want to go in there and talk to the big, bad Persian king. You don't want to talk to him, right? You don't want to tell him he's doing wrong. How do you know? The only reason you gain this access is so that you can speak truth to power. This is our legacy. We have to think about the shameful worship of money, sex, and power that trumps attention to isms. We have to think about the ways that we can encourage practical acts of solidarity. We have to have the courage to act while also holding the great need for healing. This moment means that we have to engage in resistance by telling the truth, not just in private, but in public, and especially when it's inconvenient, especially when it feels dangerous, and especially when it feels uncomfortable. We have to be people of moral conscience. We have a very interesting conundrum in that one of the ways in which religious equality has been experienced by us as a people is that a lot of us have been given the freedom to be able to walk around and call ourselves Jewish, but not really act upon it. Not be Jewish in any public way. It's just a thing, right? Well, that thing is what is supposed to inspire you and inspire others to know that when they come up and they see a Jew, they're supposed to know, not today, not today, not when there's a Jew here, not today. Jews know better. Jews stand for something. Jews have come from somewhere. And if you don't know where you come from, and if you don't know what your history teaches, and if you don't know how your culture situates you around liberation, how are you going to be prepared? So tell the truth from a place of conscience, from a place of knowing your history viscerally, and knowing that because we have come from a place where injustice has hurt our people, we will not stand for it. We will not stand for it, not for a day. Engage locally and build bridges with your close and distant neighbors. When Ferguson happened, there were a bunch of people in my community in Boston who wanted to get onto buses and drive down to St. Louis. You know what I said to them? Why are you driving down to St. Louis and you don't drive 10 blocks to the Boys and Girls Club in Dorchester? What about proximity? What about the idea of getting proximate to exactly where you live? There are probably not 10 blocks we can drive to in any urban city that is not immediately proximate to the urban blight of property. It's right next door. The question is, do we choose to see it? We have to get rid of our middle class aloofness and work as Dr. King worked to unite poor people all over the country. When he died, he was working on the Poor People's Campaign. We don't talk about that. We don't always talk about the way in which he was a champion of the poor. He was fighting a class war. The weekend he died, he was working with sanitation workers, trying to get them fair wages. This was a man of conscience. We have to humbly listen. We have to educate ourselves. We have to speak up. We have to speak out. When we hear something that sounds like racism, sounds like privilege, sounds like white supremacy, sounds like white nationalism, sounds like misogyny, we don't go, oh, he couldn't possibly have meant that. Let's find a way to just make this all comfortable. No, we can't do that. We have to educate ourselves and have a response before the moment. It's like a muscle. Sometimes you get into a moment, and by that time you're so scared, you can't get the words out. How many of you have ever been in a situation where you wish you had said something, then you go home and you talk to yourself in the mirror? Well, how could I say it? Well, how about we practice in the mirror before you encounter the situation? How about we sit with each other and we practice our response before we get there, so that when we get there, it's second nature? How about we understand that our tradition says, Kol ha'olam kulo yeshet tzav me'od, v'ha'ikar lo v'fachek tzav. The entire world is a narrow bridge, and the essence is that we shall not hear. How about we remember, tzedek tirdof, justice shall we pursue, means to always tell the truth. How about you remember that your sister came to you tonight, your sister Yavilah McCoy, came to you tonight and said, this is a Jewish problem that we need to end racism. Why is it a Jewish problem? Because we are a multiracial family. And if I am targeted and impacted, you are targeted and impacted. And when Auntie Fran comes to Thanksgiving dinner and starts saying things she should be saying, that's your problem, not mine. You don't invite me over and say, oh, you know my Auntie Fran. She can say something to me. You sit down with Auntie Fran and tell her how uncomfortable she makes you. You sit down with yourself and create an environment where any Jew of color that is among you feels viscerally how much you are willing and are engaged in working to end racism, because it is a poison and a disease for our country. And as Jews, we cannot tolerate it. I want you all to remember that when we say Shema, when we say Shema, the Shema says, Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad. That prayer is about oneness. That prayer is about witnessing the testimony. When we say that word Echad, it means that our God is a God of oneness. Our God is a God of unity. When we are really being Israel, we are united. That's what is in this week's parasha too. Jacob ended his life by telling his sons, they say, to take individual sticks. Y'all remember this story, right? Each of you bring me a stick. Broke the stick. Now I want you to put all your sticks in a bundle. You can't break the bundle, right? You can't break the bundle with all the sticks in the bundle. We are all diverse and unique, created to be individuals. But that means you have your individual work to do. It doesn't mean that your work is separate from everybody else's. So yes, be you. Be the very specific, beautiful creation that you were put in this world to be by standing up and testifying that Shema Yisrael, Yisrael has the power to show oneness, to radiate oneness to this world. And when people say that God or spirituality is about divisiveness, you better stand up and say, not in our name. So, I want you to welcome the full dimension of what it means to be Jewish. I want you to engage in complexity. I want you to build courageous relationships with a call for justice that resonates outward. I want you to build beloved spaces of peace, power, and love. And I want you to be a Jewish family that matters. May it all be.